This is Professor Rogers. In this presentation, we discuss the normal distribution. We describe the characteristics of the normal curve, show how to convert any distribution of points to the standard normal distribution, summarize simple tests for normality, and demonstrate how to transform a non-normal distribution of data into a normal distribution. We all know the normal distribution. It is commonly called the bell curve. All normal curves are a variation of the standard normal curve, which has a mean of 0 and a standard deviation of 1. This curve is often abbreviated using the capital letter N with a 0 followed by a 1 in parentheses. 0 for the mean and 1 for the standard deviation. The normal distribution is one of several distributions encountered in statistics, but arguably the most important to understand. Many inferential statistics assume numeric data is normally distributed. I stress that what we are discussing applies only to numeric data. Characteristics of the normal curve provide the basis for understanding confidence intervals and statistical significance. When we need an example in this presentation, it will come from a data set containing the 50 states. We will look at three variables: the number of people, population for short, the poverty rate, calculated as the percent of people living below the poverty line, and percent urban, the percentage of people living in census-defined urban places. The normal distribution has three characteristics. First, the mean, median, and mode are the same points. Second, the distribution is symmetrical. If one side of the curve were folded on top of the other side of the curve, the shape of the left half of the curve would be the same as the right half. Finally, the distribution of the points under the curve is known and is expressed geometrically as the area under the curve. The mean and the standard deviation tell us a lot about the curve. About 68% of points fall within one standard deviation of the mean. About 95% of points fall within two standard deviations of the mean. Over 99% of points fall within three standard deviations of the mean. Thus, if we assume that a distribution of points is normally distributed, the combination of the mean and standard deviation give us enough information to make a sketch of the distribution. Any distribution of points can be expressed in units of the standard normal distribution by converting its values to what is called a z-score, or standardized score. The z-score standardizes any normal curve into the standard normal curve. The calculation is simple. Subtract the mean from any point and divide by the standard deviation. If the point is less than the mean, the z-score will have a negative coefficient. If the point is more than the mean, the z-score will have a positive coefficient. Here the poverty rate for Ohio is used as an example. The national mean for the poverty rate is 15.19, and the standard deviation is 3.30. The value for Ohio is 16.4. These numbers are plugged in the equation, and we determine the z-score with simple arithmetic. Thus, we find that the z-score for Ohio is approximately 0.37. Whether the z-score is positive or negative depends on the relationship of the observation to the mean. Ohio has a poverty rate greater than the national mean, so its z-score is positive. Here is the calculation for Pennsylvania. Pennsylvania's poverty rate is less than the national mean, so its z-score is negative. With this information, the location of the values of these states can be pinpointed on the standard normal curve. Their approximate location is shown here. The mean of the distribution has a z-score of 0. the z-score of a 0.1 standard deviation above the mean is 1. The z-score of a 0.1 standard deviation below the mean is minus 1. All this information is useful, but we have yet to address a key question. Is the distribution of points normal? Many of the earliest statistics were developed to study natural phenomena, which often conform to recognizable patterns and have only random deviations from the central tendency. Social behavior is very different, and we are continually concerned about whether our data conform to the assumption of normality. There are 4 easy ways to check for normality using histograms, statistics for skewness and kurtosis, and data on outliers. The histogram provides a visual test for normality. Here is an example of a histogram from SPSS, a leading software package, using the variable population from our state-level dataset. To create a histogram, the distance between the minimum and maximum values is split in segments of equal length. Then the frequency of each length is determined. The frequency for some segments is higher than others, and given this rule for dividing the data, we could get gaps where there are no observations in the segment. The frequencies are visually represented in boxes, which are referred to as bins. Notice that the distribution of population does not have the shape of a normal distribution. If the distribution looked normal or almost normal, we would leave the data alone. However, the distribution of population is not normal, which is a sign that we may need to transform our data once we learn more about our distribution. Excel can produce a histogram, but it is a poor quality one. Here we see a histogram for the variable population from the state's data used for this example. In Excel, we begin in the Data Analysis Toolpack with the Histogram command. Here is the dialog box for the command. 2 parts of the dialog box are filled in. The input range is the range of cells for the variable population. The label box is also checked because the range includes the variable label in the first row of the selected data. The output is a small table, which is here seen in the upper left-hand corner of the spreadsheet. A visual representation can be made by creating a column chart. The entire table is highlighted, and the column chart is selected from the pre-formatted graphs under the Insert tab. There are also statistics tests for normality that can be found in the output for descriptive statistics. These 2 numbers are the skewness and kurtosis. Skewness describes the wobble or lean of the distribution. The normal distribution is symmetric, but a distribution that is skewed is asymmetric, leaning one way or the other. We describe the lean using the location of the long tail. If the long tail is on the left side of the distribution is said to have a negative skew, or is said to be skewed to the left. If the long tail is on the right side of the distribution is said to have a positive skew, or is said to be skewed to the right. In our example, the population histogram has a right skew, or is skewed to the right. The value of the skewness statistic is 0 if the distribution is normal. Recognizing that such a perfect distribution is rare, the issue is how much tolerance we should show for deviation from 0. Here's the rule of thumb. A distribution is seen as being too skewed to the left if the skewness number is less than minus 2, and it is seen as too skewed to the right if the number is greater than 2. Between minus 2 and 2, we do not regard the distribution as skewed. These numbers are highlighted in this output. Poverty rate and percent urban fall in an acceptable range. We do not regard them as skewed. Population has skewness greater than 2, so we regard population as skewed to the right. Kurtosis has to do with the height of the distribution. The issue is seen as important because it affects whether there is enough variation in the variable between the low and high values. After all, by definition, a variable has to have variation. If the distribution is flat, it is said to be platykurtic. Using the kurtosis statistic, we regard the distribution as flat if the kurtosis statistic is less than minus 2. We often do not care about this situation because a flat distribution has plenty of variation. We are more concerned about distributions that are too tall and skinny, or what we call leptokurtic. We know this situation is present when the kurtosis statistic exceeds the value of 2. Here the kurtosis statistic is highlighted in the output. Note that again, the only variable that is not normal is population. Another issue affecting the normality of a distribution is the presence of outliers. Outliers are points that are far away from the main distribution of points. Here I highlight the maximum value in the histogram for population in the state-level dataset. Notice that the point stands apart from the rest of the data. Outliers distort statistical summaries. They inflate or deflate the values for the mean and standard deviation, and they can affect the parameters of bivariate and multivariate analyses in ways that lead to erroneous findings. The question that we must address is whether the point is so far away from the main distribution that we care. We use positional descriptive statistics to determine whether a point is an outlier. With the low values of the distribution, a point is regarded as an outlier if we take the 25th percentile and subtract 1.5 times the interquartile range. On the high end of the distribution, we take 1.5 times the interquartile range and add it to the 75th percentile. Here are the calculations for outliers for the population variable worked out on each end of the distribution. On the low end, a point is an outlier if the population of the state is less than minus 5,098,298.1. The number is negative. Obviously, there are no states with negative population sizes, so we do not have to worry about outliers that are at the low end of the distribution. On the high end of the distribution, a state is an outlier if its population exceeds 13,890,038.9. The maximum value of the distribution is greater than the threshold for an outlier, so we conclude that there is one or more outliers in the distribution. For inferential statistics to work correctly, we need to fix distributions whenever they are not normal. The issue is complicated because the issues of skewness, kurtosis, and outliers might be related. If we address skewness, some other issues go away. Here are a set of steps that I find useful. First, we do our checks for normality, which we have already done in this presentation. We look at the histograms and the statistics for skewness and kurtosis. It is possible that these different measures do not agree with each other, so we have to make a judgment call. I sometimes say that statistics is more like art than science, and this judgment call is one of the places where the artistic side of statistics appears. To fix skewness, we transform the data using the so-called ladder of powers. There are two columns on the chart, the first column being the transformation we might perform, and the second one the corresponding Excel expression to be applied to each observation. The value identity is the variable that we have untransformed. We move up the ladder if we have skewness to the left. We move down the ladder if we have skewness to the right. Since population is skewed to the right, we can attempt a logarithmic transformation of the population variable. Population can be found in E2, and the transformed variable is placed in I2. Once set, we copy the value I2 to other cells. Whether we move up or down the ladder, we try one transformation at a time until we find one that works. We can go past the ones shown here, but it is not customary because the extreme transformations are not intuitive. Here is the histogram of the log of population. Notice how the curve looks much more normal now, and there are no points standing apart from the main distribution. Here are the descriptive statistics for population and its logged variable side by side. Notice how the logarithmic transformation brings the skewness and kurtosis within acceptable levels. We lucked out. Our first transformation was successful. If it were not initially successful, we would move one rung at a time until we were done. The thing about transformations is that they do not always work. Normally, we limit ourselves to only a few rungs on the ladder simply because the data becomes transformed so much that we may find it hard to describe what we did, even if the transformation is mathematically acceptable. Dealing with kurtosis can be tough. We use the same transformations we use for skewness, but they do not always work. If they do not work, there is no good test to tell us what to do. It becomes a judgment call about whether or not we should keep the variable. If we find an acceptable transformation, we can remove outlying points one at a time until we get a distribution with no outliers. In this presentation, we have looked at the normal distribution. We learned how to test a distribution for normality and what to do if the data is not normal. Unlike the natural sciences, social research often relies on data that does not conform nicely to the normal distribution. This fact can undermine much of what we seek to accomplish with data analysis. These statements are not our final ones on the topic. The question of dealing with normality and outliers returns at a more advanced level of analysis when we deal with regression diagnostics, where we review our work and perhaps change our minds.